Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. You know, when you attend conferences and seminars in the business world, and they say, and it's also part of the public speaking manual, that when you're about to address an audience that's feeling somewhat lethargic, somewhat sleepy, somewhat lazy, it is after all midway through a Saturday morning, and you must get them to do something physical to wake them up so they pay attention to what you have to say. I don't want you to do that because you just got up not so long ago to do this next, but perhaps we can try the salam again. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. That's much better, mashallah. The real reason I didn't want you to do that, because the second half of that particular point is that the speaker must also do the physical activity from the front. So I went to one seminar, and to get everybody going, the guy said, let's do 3 push-ups. And I'm not going to attempt that under any circumstances. Actually, I was also feeling somewhat lethargic. I was sitting there at the back, and I saw that obviously because of reasons they gave Maulana Ismail Bamji the chair. And I thought, I wonder if they give me the option, or perhaps they just leave the chair. But they brought it back to the podium. So I got to focus, I got to stand. Yesterday I was sharing something, you know, about laziness in the Jummah Bayan. One guy said, I'm not lazy. I'm just highly motivated to do nothing. So let's all be highly motivated to do something today, inshallah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, nahmaduhu wa nusalli ala rasulihi al-kareem, amma ba'd. I think firstly, I feel obligated to say and to echo the words of Hassan bin Thabit radiallahu anhu, that we are not really praising Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by sitting here and speaking and listening to the life story of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rather, we are making our words, and we are making our time, and we are making our effort, and we are making our lives praiseworthy by talking and studying the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I'm sure that the previous speakers, and especially those who did the initial discussions last night, may have emphasized this point, that this is a great bounty from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has selected us, Allah has chosen us, and Allah has blessed us with the ability to take that decision, to make that effort, to give that time, to congregate here on a weekend, to study the life of the greatest creation of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whilst we know this point, we ought to remind ourselves as to why we are here, and we ought to renew our intentions. And perhaps we need to just take a moment from the bottom of our hearts to thank Allah that Allah has chosen us to be here in such a gathering where we are discussing the lifestyle and the life story and lessons from the life of the most beloved of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know, if a notice had to be sent out that there is a seminar where you have to pay a few $100, but you will be taught how to make money, maximum money in a short amount of time, guaranteed results, then perhaps we would have had thousands of people, because we attach value to those things. So the fact that Allah has brought us here, and Allah has given us some indication as to the value of learning more about the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is something for which we need to be thankful to Almighty Allah for. And there's one more point I would mention before we get into the subject matter proper, and I'm sure the others have echoed the same sentiment, but a reminder is beneficial for the believers. This is but just a course over 2 or 2.5 days. The minimum that needs to come out from here is each one of us needs to make this intention that I will read at least one different book of seerah every year of my life. Let's make this one intention. If we can make this one intention, and if we can implement it, and it doesn't matter how much you know, because this is for scholars as well, that every year in your life, read one different book on the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's such a life that every author will bring to the fore different lessons, different angles, different perspectives. That is part of the miracle of the Nubuwwah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Alright, the first part of my discussion has to do with the second Hijrah to Abyssinia. Obviously, to create a context for the second Hijrah to Abyssinia, you need to talk a little bit about the first Hijrah to Abyssinia. Maulana Ismail Sahib did say that in his next presentation, he will focus on the details of it, but let me just give it to you in short, what the first Hijrah was about, so it creates a context for the second Hijrah to Abyssinia. When the persecution upon the Muslims had reached levels that were becoming intolerable, then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had indicated to the Muslims that spread out in the land of Allah. Spread out in the land of Allah and go to a place where it will be more conducive for you to worship Allah. Now let's just pause for a moment there. Somewhere in between you may also read, I don't know if it will be part of the presentation, about the hijrah of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And what was the purpose of that? They wanted to leave Mecca, the best of places, where the Kaaba is situated, where the Nabi of Allah is present, which is their birthplace. Why? Because they are looking for an environment that is more conducive, that will allow them more latitude and more freedom to worship Allah. Now let's just ask ourselves a very relevant but a very difficult question. We here as Muslims in South Africa are perhaps in the country in which the environment is most conducive. People have to come from other parts of the world, perhaps even Muslim countries, and they will find it more conducive to worship Allah in this country. And to what extent do we appreciate that bounty of Allah? We talk about it for sure. All the time we mention about religious freedom here in South Africa, but to what extent do we practice and do we implement the deen of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala? Because that's actual gratitude. Verbalizing gratitude is but a starting point. Actual gratitude is when you maximize on the opportunity. When you maximize on the opportunity. So the Sahaba asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, you're saying, okay, spread out on the earth. Where do you think we should go? So the Nabi of Allah indicated towards Habasha, towards Abyssinia. And he gave a reason. He said, I have heard that there is a leader there who is very just, and he will treat his subjects justly. This aspect and this quality of justice is something which is very emphasized in the Quran. It is very emphasized also in the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as Muslims today, it's the same thing that we ask the world. That treat us justly. That's all we're asking. Let justice prevail. And the system of Allah, if it is followed politically, economically, socially, and in every other way, if you follow the teachings of Islam, justice will prevail. Because it is underpinned by justice. And the second point on justice is, many times we make a mistake and we think that justice is only relevant to the political leaders. Those who are sitting in the higher echelons of political power, they need to be just. Of course they need to be. But each one of us needs to be just. As heads of our households, are we just? As parents, are we just? As employers, are we just? As employees, are we just? Because each one of us, our individual injustice then contributes to a climate that is not so fair and not so conducive. So that is why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam indicated them towards Abyssinia. And there were a number of Sahaba, including the son-in-law of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Uthman radiallahu anhu, and his wife, the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ruqayya radiallahu anha. They made hijrah to Abyssinia, and this was the first hijrah to Abyssinia. They stayed there for a short while, and then they got a message, which was actually not a factual message, that look, circumstances in Makkah have improved. They're no longer persecuting the Muslims, they're now more tolerant, they're allowing them the freedom to do what they want, and Makkah is where they really wanted to be. So they returned to Makkah only to find that that information was false. Now that brings us then to the aspect, so that's just a short context, and Maulana will elaborate further in his subsequent presentation. But then it brings us to the second hijrah to Abyssinia. Now what was the reason here? Once again they returned, and the persecution now was going to unprecedented levels, to higher levels. We hear about all those stories of how the different Sahaba were persecuted, and some of them even lost their lives. So once again, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had given a permission for hijrah to be made to Abyssinia. And now it was already a tried formula, because they had been there before, and they saw that indeed, in the country, they treat you justly, and you are allowed to live at peace and to exist in harmony with people of other faiths, because Najashi or Negus was Christian. Now, when they made this hijrah, the second hijrah, it was under the leadership of Ja'far bin Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, and we'll talk more about him in a short while. They came, they stayed there for a while. But now there was this Aina. There was something that was pricking at the Quraysh, at the Mushrikeen, at the polytheists. Those people were far away. They were in a distant land, and especially in those days, I mean, it took quite a while to travel from Makkah to Mukarramah to Abyssinia. But the Quraysh had this nagging fear that, listen, they are too comfortable there. You see, when there's animosity, when someone's got it in for you, if you are not an immediate threat to them, that is also not sufficient for them. They don't want you to become a threat in the future also. They don't want you to find any peace, any solace in your life. So the Mushrikeen were thinking far ahead. They said, hey, they seem to be too comfortable there. It mustn't be that they regroup, that they find their motivation, that they find their feet, and then they come back and they then present a new threat. They present a new threat for us. So we need to rein them in. We need to bring them back. So they sent the emissaries. Two individuals. The one is Amr bin As, who later on became a Sahabi radiallahu anhu, and Abdullah ibn Abi Rabi'ah. Amr bin As, I don't have the time to go into details, he was a very astute diplomat. If you read history and if you read what happened later on, especially after he became a Muslim, you will understand. And he became a great Sahabi. There's that famous hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that when he asked the Nabi of Allah that if I accept Islam, will my past be forgiven? Including the past in terms of the role that he played here. And the Nabi of Allah told him, al-Islamu yahdimu ma kana qabla. Whatever happened before, when you say la ilaha illallah, it wipes the slate clean. Look at the system of Allah. Just marvel at the system of Allah. We'll talk now about the role that Amr bin As radiallahu anhu played in trying to compromise the Muslims. But when hidayat is written, it's written. When hidayat is written, it's written. Never ever write off anybody. No matter what they are doing. Never ever write them off. His son, Abdullah bin Amr, became one of the greatest narrator of ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, these are the two guys, the two individuals, they sent to Abyssinia. So, very astute, very shrewd, very smart. He comes with a lot of gifts. Till today, that particular tactic reigns supreme. You hear all about the political narrative today in South Africa and everywhere else. When you're giving gifts, or when you're giving sweetness, right, you're going to get your way. That's how politics works. So Abdullah bin Amr understands something. And this is ironic about the mushrikeen. They knew the value, they knew the benefit, they knew the power of Islam. They had their own personal jealousies and their own tribal rivalries, which in the main was the reason for preventing them from accepting Islam. On the quiet, as you may have heard, he used to actually go and listen to the Quran. So you did not want Ja'far bin Abi Talib to have an audience with Najashi to explain to him what is Islam. So when they got there, they didn't go to the leader himself first. They went to his courtiers, they went to his ministers, and they bribed them with gifts. They told them, listen, see here, we are pagans, you guys are Christians. These people have forsaken the religion of their forefathers, but they haven't come to your religion. They've adopted something totally new, which is a threat to us and is a threat to you as well. So why do you want to handle them? Give them back to us. Let there be not too much discussion around this. Give them back to us. We'll take them back to Makkah. They are our problem. They are our turncoats, so to speak, and we'll deal with them. So the courtiers fell for it because they already got the sweetener. They already got the sweetener. And he put before them this kind of diplomatic logic that, listen, give them to us, we'll sort them out. These people are a sleeping terror cell. You don't want to use modern terminology. They are a sleeping terror cell in your own country. They're going to pose a political threat to you before they come back and pose a political threat to us. So let's do the extradition. You give them back to us, we'll take them to our Guantanamo and we'll sort them out. But Najashi was a man of justice and fairness, and that's why I emphasized the point initially. When they presented this to him, not only did he reject it, he got extremely angry. He said, what kind of proposition is this? That I must merely on your side of the story hand over people who haven't up to yet posed the problem to me. I'm not listening to this. I want to hear both sides of the story. So coming to the picture now is Ja'far bin Abi Talib, who was the leader now of those who had made Hijrah to Abyssinia. And who was Ja'far bin Abi Talib? If I may just for a moment give you some insight. Ja'far radiallahu anhu was the cousin of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was the son of Abu Talib. He was the brother of Ali radiallahu anhu. They mentioned that from amongst the five individuals that most resembled Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam physically, Ja'far radiallahu anhu was one of them. Ja'far radiallahu anhu was martyred on the battlefields of Muta. His qabr is not very far away there in Jordan. And that's an entire story to read, his bravery, his courage. He had a wife, Asma bint Umays, another woman with a profound legacy. If we have the time, not we should make the time to read about these personalities, because they're all linked to the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A very interesting story I'll mention to you. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam financially was now on his own feet, remember Abu Talib was looking after him. Abu Talib had many children, and the Nabi of Allah one day went to his uncle Abbas, the brother of Abu Talib, and said, you know, our uncle is struggling financially to look after all of his children. Why don't you adopt one and I'll adopt one to alleviate his financial difficulty? So Abbas radiallahu anhu said, no, you made a good suggestion. So they went to Abu Talib, and Abu Talib said, okay, choose anyone from my children, just leave Aqil for me. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam chose Ali radiallahu anhu. And that's how Ali radiallahu anhu grew up in the house of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Abbas radiallahu anhu chose Ja'far radiallahu anhu. So he grew up in the house of Abbas radiallahu anhu, his uncle. And he was very eloquent in speech. So he came to the court of Najashi, and Najashi said, what's this that we're hearing, that you've forsaken your own religion, nor are you turning to our religion? This is something totally new. What is this? So if we look at the next slide, I mean, it was a lengthy sermon and I don't have the time to go through it, but some of the key points that Ja'far radiallahu anhu made. Ja'far radiallahu anhu, when they entered the court, the first thing that created a bit of an issue was they did not follow the custom of making sajda. And the courtiers were very upset and they said, you are being disrespectful. But this is where we highlight the point that no matter what the circumstances or how much your back may be against the wall, those things which are fundamental to your faith, and prostrating before anyone besides Allah is a fundamental of faith, you don't compromise it under any circumstance. So they asked, and the Najashi said, why don't you make prostration? Why don't you prostrate in front of me? They said, our Nabi has taught us that we prostrate only before our Creator. But we make salam to you. We make salam to you. And then they taught him the benefit of salam, and they also educated him that salam will be the greeting of those people who make it to Jannah. So they were not rude and arrogant. This is also something sometimes when we go to the other extreme, this is what my religion teaches me, that's it. Like it or lump it. No. Listen, yeah, we understand you have your protocol, we understand you have your customs, but for us it's difficult because our Nabi has taught us that you don't prostrate before any human. This is the logical reasoning behind it. You prostrate only before the maker of all humans, but to honor you, we will honor you with the best greeting. And this is the value and this is the virtue of that greeting. And Najashi accepted it and he said, fine. So Ja'far radiallahu anhu gives the sermon and he gives the background, he gives some perspective. He says, look, we were a nation, we were burning our daughters alive, we were killing each other, we were involved in every vice. Even the superpowers of the time did not want to rule over us. And this is what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us, and this is how he has changed our lives. Now the point I want to highlight here is when interacting with non-Muslims, you need to show some sort of logic as to why you take the position that you are taking. He did not walk in the old pompous and say, right, I believe in Allah and Allah will assist us. And listen, you're on your way to hell because you believe that Isa is the son of Allah rather than the servant of Allah, and we are on our way to Jannah and we are right and you are wrong. No. He made him see logically why they left the religion of their ancestors and forefathers and why they're adopting this particular religion. They made him see the wisdom in it. They made him see the reason in it. And after giving this, it's famous, it's a well-known incident. We spoke about the Quran, that Allah revealed the Quran. So Najashi asked, do you have anything with you from the Quran which we can listen to? And look at the astute selection here of Ja'far radiallahu anhu. He chooses Surah Maryam, knowing that Najashi is a Christian. And knowing that the story of Maryam would be very close to the heart of this leader. And it is mentioned and it is famous that by the time he completed reciting from Surah Maryam what he had recited, not only was Najashi crying to the extent that his entire beard was filled with tears, those courtiers were already corrupted with the bride. They cried to the extent that the books that they had before them had become wet with their tears. Such was the power of the Quran and the Kalam of Allah. And then Najashi made the statement and he said, what you have read, it comes from the same source that what Isa bin Maryam taught us, meaning that the Bible, the original Injil, you can see it comes from the same source. And then he told Abdullah bin Amr and Abdullah bin Abi Rabi'ah, I'm not going to surrender them. But Abdullah bin Amr bin As radiallahu anhuma was not going to give up. And I'll tell you what happened next, but if you just look at this other slide, just to highlight again that aspect of logic. You see, when somebody accuses you, no matter how false or how baseless the accusation may be, don't retort and don't respond with emotion, respond with facts. Respond calmly with facts. So Ja'far radiallahu anhu asked three questions. Then why do you want us to come back? Why do you want us to be handed over to you? Are we slaves that we belong to somebody and we ran away? The answer is no. Have we fled after committing murder or committing any crime? The answer is no. Have we fled after stealing someone's wealth or usurping someone's wealth? The answer is no. So by asking these three questions, he was highlighting and he was emphasizing and underlining this point to Najashi. They have no basis for which to come and insist that we be handed over to them. He could have gone on a tirade and said, do you know who these people are? Do you know what they want to do with us? Do you know what they did to us? Do you know what liars they are and what schemers they are? But that would have been an emotional argument. No, he came forward and he said, listen, let's look at the facts. Are we guilty of anything that we need to be returned? We're not guilty of anything. So then we must be given the right and the privilege to reside wherever we want. And this obviously appealed to his sense of logic and to his sense of justice. But then Abdullah bin Amr bin As radiallahu anhumam, he said, no, I'm not going to give up and I'm not going to return here defeated. My integrity, my profile is at stake. So what he did, he said, tomorrow I'm going back to Najashi. And this time I'm going to tell him such a thing. He will be left so enraged that he's not going to spare any one of them. And everyone knew what he was referring to. Even his partner, Ibn Abi Rabi'a, said, no, don't do that. In the end of the day, these are our people. We just wanted to take them back. If you're going to bring that issue onto the table, he's going to kill them. And what was the issue? He was going to tell Najashi that these people blaspheme your God, meaning Isa alayhi salam. They don't believe him to be God or the son of God. They believe him to be a mere servant of Allah. And the Muslims were in a state of panic. And they had a meeting the night before and they said, what will we do? And Ja'far radiallahu anhu said, it's rather simple. We will tell him exactly what Nabi sallallahu alayhi salam told us about Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. And that is what transpired. The next day, Abdullah bin Amr, or rather Amr bin As radiallahu anhu goes. He tells Najashi, ask them what is their belief with regards Isa alayhi salam. And Najashi asks them, and they respond very factually. They say, we believe, as per the teachings of our Nabi, that he is the son, servant of Allah, Abdullah. He is the son of Maryam, Ibn Maryam. He was born miraculously without the intervention of a father. He is Ruhullah. He is Kalimatullah. But that's it. He is not Allah, and he is not the son of Allah. The ministers and the priests were infuriated. But Najashi stood up, and it's mentioned in the books of history, he took a grain of sand, and he said, what you have said is not at variance with what Isa alayhi salam originally taught, even to the extent of this one grain of sand. And he said, now the matter is closed. I don't want to hear anything further. These people will reside here for as long as they want to reside. And then Abdullah bin Amr, rather Amr bin As and Ibn Abi Rabi'ah had to then returned to Makkah very defeated, and the Muslims remained there for many years. But there's one interesting story that Aisha radiallahu anha speaks about when it comes to Najashi's ascension to the throne. And the real lesson behind this is, you know, the verse that we commonly hear about, wa makaru wa makar Allah, others plan and Allah plans, and Allah's plan will always prevail. Najashi's uncle was the king of Abyssinia, and he had 12 sons. Najashi's father was the brother, and he had, no, sorry, the other way around. Najashi's father was the king, but he had only one son, Najashi. And his uncle had 12 sons. So in their twisted logic, the people felt, hey, our king is old, he's going to die, he's got only one son. So this kind of, this power will not last for many generations because he's got only one son. But the brother is a better option because the brother has 12 sons. So for continuity and perpetuity, it's a better option. So they killed Najashi's father. So he came now, he was young, he came into the custody of his uncle. But look at the plan of Allah. Allah had blessed him with such brilliance that he outshone all of his cousins. And his uncle gave him a lot of affairs of the state to handle because of his brilliance. So the people once again thought, hey, this is even a bigger problem. Because this boy will not forget what we did to his father. And the day the uncle's eyes close, he'll take the seat and he's going to exact revenge for us, from us, in terms of what we did to his father. So they came to the king and they made it clear to the king that this boy needs to be killed. So the king said, no, I will not allow a second injustice to be perpetrated. But the king also was politically astute. He understood that, you know what, if he doesn't give in to some extent, they'll remove him. The kind of mob mentality. So he said, the best I can do is no killing here. We're not going to shed any further blood. We're going to take him and banish him. We're going to take him. So they sold him off as a slave. And they told the person who bought him, take him wherever you want. So he's out of the political equation. But look at the system of Allah. That same night, the uncle dies. The same night, the uncle dies. And none of the uncle's sons have shown any kind of talent, nor do they have any experience to ascend to the throne. So those very people come back and say, oh wait, that guy is the best option under the circumstance. So they pursue him, they bring him back, they pay that guy whatever he bought, and they put him on the throne. And that's why he made the statement. When he sent Abdullah bin Amr, or rather Amr bin As back, radiallahu anh, he said, take all your gifts back. Because Allah gave me this throne without any bribery. I'm not going to start with bribery now. I came to this position by the divine plan of Allah. No matter how everyone else was scheming against me, I am not going to now soil my hands and soil my leadership with this. You know, it's a great lesson for us to learn. Many times we look at these things again only from the prism and the perspective of political leadership, but all of us are leaders in some capacity or the other. Many times we hear people, you know, moaning or bemoaning the fact he was very humble before he got onto the seat. But when he got onto the seat of power, he forgot what he was like and what it was like before he ascended to the seat of power. Najashi didn't forget. And that was remarkable about him. He said, I'm not going to start now. I haven't forgot that lesson that Allah taught me by the way in which Allah brought me. Then some years later, Ja'far radiallahu anhu and the Sahaba decided to go to Medina because Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had made hijrah and they had established the Islamic state. And Najashi paid for all the journey provisions and he sent one messenger with them. And the messenger came to Medina and he told Ja'far radiallahu anhu, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was just returning from the conquest of Khaybar, which was a major victory for the Muslims against the Jews. And the Nabi of Allah said, I don't know whether I'm happier with the conquest of Khaybar or with the return of Ja'far bin Abi Talib. And then the messenger of Najashi said, tell your Nabi how our king treated you. And Ja'far radiallahu anhu gave the very glowing report back. And then he said that Najashi, Ya Rasulullah, has sent me to tell you that he also bears testimony to the Shahada and he is also a Muslim. And he asked that you make dua that Allah forgive him. And immediately Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stood up and said, Allahumma aghfir li Najashi, that Allah forgive him. And as we know, later on when he passed away, the Nabi of Allah also made salatul janazah for him. So you know, if you want to talk about leadership, that's a great example. But time doesn't permit for me to go into too much of detail or too much of further detail in that particular regard. But from one great leader, we move on to the story of one of the greatest leaders that the human race has ever seen. And we talk very quickly about the acceptance of Islam by Umar bin Khattab radiallahu anhu. The first slide there has the dua of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That Allah strengthen Islam particularly with Umar bin Khattab radiallahu anhu. But there was a dua prior to this where the Nabi of Allah made dua and he said, oh Allah, honor Islam either with Abu Jahl accepting Islam or Umar bin Khattab accepting Islam, whatever of the two that you choose. And Ibn Asakir says that at some point Allah revealed to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that Abu Jahl will never accept Islam. So that's why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam amended his dua. I want to pause at this point to highlight one lesson. Umar bin Khattab radiallahu anhu was a staunch enemy of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Right? At a time when the Muslims were going through a lot of difficulty, not in Medina, in Makkah, when the number of Muslims were small. And here's your staunch, aggressive, vocal enemy. Yet what is the Nabi of Allah doing? He is identifying talent. In his enemy, in his arch enemy, he saw that this man has talent. If Allah brings him over this side, it will boost the cause of Islam. Today, any teacher can teach the obedient student. Any parent can parent the obedient child. But seek the talent in the rebellious one, in the disobedient one. Mature that talent. That is not only an accomplishment. That is also a sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We want to banish people to the rubbish bin. When they show some resistance, when they show some rebellion, when they show some disobedience, fire him, excommunicate him, disown him, do this, do that. It's very easy to do all of that. And sometimes, ultimately it needs to be done. But the Nabi of Allah identified talent even in Abu Jahl. That's why he was making dua. But Allah had this time for Umar bin Khattab radiallahu anhu. The second lesson we learned from here, I just mentioned it, we don't have time to go into the detail, is the power of dua. When we hear all of those wonderful stories of what Umar achieved, when we hear of all of those words with which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam praised Umar radiallahu anhu, لو كان بعدي نبيا لكان عمر, if there was to be a Nabi after me, it would have been Umar. What brought Umar to Islam? Dua. And then today we say, but how much more dua must I make? Obviously dua must not become a crutch. Dua must not become an excuse for the lack of action, for the lack of activism, for the lack of thinking and deliberation on how best to approach situations. But dua should never be trivialized and dua should never be undermined. The first victory in Islam, Badr, preceded by dua. The acceptance of Islam by Umar, preceded by the dua of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Right, so the events that led to Umar radiallahu anhu accepting Islam, there's 3 points there. Abu Jahl had put a bounty on the head of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the Nabi of Allah was put on the hit list and he was put on number one. And he said 100 camels, I mean, which was a huge reward at the time. And Umar radiallahu anhu went personally to verify that is it true, 100 camels? He said yes. And Umar radiallahu anhu set out to kill the Nabi of Allah. I just want to provide some context here, right? I was mentioning about how the Nabi of Allah nurtured talent. There's one narration where Umar radiallahu anhu, later on in his life, when he's Amir al-Mu'mineen, one day he starts crying. And he says, you know, there was a time in my life when I couldn't even look after sheep. I couldn't even look after sheep. And my father Khattab said to me, Umar, what will become of you in life? You can't have to look after sheep. But the Nabi of Allah identified talent and he nurtured the talent. And Umar is Umar. Umar had become Umar because of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His own father was near giving up hope on him. Right? And there's something that's not mentioned in Sirat al-Mustafa, but I read it elsewhere, that Umar radiallahu anhu said, you know, when I went out to kill the Nabi of Allah, I was actually fighting my own internal demons. He says, I had started to realize the beauty of Islam. But it was something that I could not feel, it's something that was not palatable to me. So I had to do something to contradict that which was starting to speak to me, the inner voice. And that's why it was Abu Jahl's bounty on the one hand, but on the other hand, he thought, hey, this what I'm thinking here inside is too dangerous. Islam is actually starting to appeal to me. So he had two motives as to why he wanted to kill Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then the second thing is on his way, he meets Nu'aym bin Abdullah. Nu'aym bin Abdullah says, where are you going in such a hurry? He says, I'm going to kill the Nabi of Allah. So he says, but you know, he's got family. And Arabs are tribal, very tribal. Even if they don't follow him, even if they don't believe him, but if you kill one of their own, if you kill one of their own, they won't let you go. How are you going to handle it? So he said, hey, why are you becoming so defensive? It's not your family. I think you also have become apostate, you know, turned apostate from that perspective. And so to deflect the attention from him, because Umar was ferocious in his temper and he was very bold in his courage. He said, hey, don't worry about me. What about your own sister? She's turned apostate, meaning she's left the religion of her forefathers and she's accepted Islam. So in a rage, he forgets about the Nabi of Allah and he comes to the house of his sister. And she and her husband, Sa'id bin Zayd, are being tutored in the Quran by Khabbab radiallahu anhu. And Umar had such a reputation that when Khabbab radiallahu anhu had him coming, he ran for cover. So Umar radiallahu anhu comes in and says, is it true? So before the sister could answer, the brother-in-law intervenes and says, what do you expect us to do? If we see a religion that's better than the religion we are following, you expect us to ignore it. So Umar ran for him, Skopskit and Donner. Right, full throttle. Now a wife cannot tolerate to see her husband being abused by her own brother, so she intervenes. Now you know, it's man on man. When it's man on man, he throws, you throw. One punch this way, one punch. But then she intervened, and when he hit her in the whole crossfire, and she started bleeding, so automatically even he felt embarrassed. Hey, my sister, she's a woman, she's bleeding. So he simmered down somewhat. But the flame of Islam had already ignited because of the dua of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he said, what were you reading just as I walked in? So they took out the Quran. They took out the Quran. And Umar radiallahu anhu started reading. Taha, ma anzalna alayka al-Qur'ana litashqa illa tadhkiratan liman yakhsha tanzeelan mimman khalaqa al-ardha was-samawati al-'ula ar-rahmanu 'ala al-'arshi istawa lahu ma fi as-samawati wa ma fi al-ardi wa ma baynahuma wa ma tahta ath-thara. By now all resistance had melted. Umar radiallahu anhu said, take me to the Nabi of Allah. Khabbab radiallahu anhu came running out, he embraced him, he said, my Nabi made dua and now the dua has been accepted. You know, one point comes to mind, that Umar, whose heart was so hard that he wanted to kill the Nabi of Allah, that he was beating up his own sister, when he was exposed by mistake, he never came with the intention of listening to the Quran. When he was exposed by mistake to the Quran, it had such an effect on his heart that Umar who wanted to kill the Nabi of Allah, today lies resting next to the Nabi of Allah, will be resurrected in the company of the Nabi of Allah, and will have a home right next to the Nabi of Allah in Jannah for eternity. How often do we allow the Quran to work its magic on our hearts? If it could work its magic on the hard heart of Umar radiallahu anhu, he goes to Dari Arqam where Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is, he knocks on the door, who is it? It's Umar. And automatically there's panic. We can't allow this man in because they still know him by his profile. And then Hamza radiallahu anhu said, no, let him come in. If he's come with the right intention, then alhamdulillah. If he's come with the wrong intention, Allah will help him, help us against him. As he walks in, they grab him by his shoulders. Now giving him an opportunity to make any maneuver, because they understood he wanted the head of the Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then they give him a private audience with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Nabi of Allah says, Umar, accept Islam. Umar, accept Islam. He says, Ya Nabi Allah, I have come to say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam is so happy. He screams out the takbir, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Jibril alayhi salatu wasalam comes from the heavens and says, O Muhammad, the angels are joining you and celebrating the acceptance of Islam by Umar bin Khattab radiallahu anhu. As emotional as we can be on such an occasion, let me ask you, how many of us can stand unprepared and speak for longer than 10 minutes on the life of Umar? But I can tell you, if I tell you to stand up and talk about your favorite political subject or your favorite sporting subject, you'll speak for a couple of hours on end. So yes, we love Umar, and yes, we get emotional when we hear the story of Umar, but how much do we learn about Umar, and how much do we follow in terms of the life lessons that come through in the life of Umar radiallahu anhu? This man, when exposed to dua and when exposed to Quran, look at where Allah took him. Look at where Allah took him. The progress and the success of Islam in the 12 years of rule of Umar bin Khattab radiallahu anhu. How many times he would express an opinion and the Quran would come down in revelation conforming to the opinion of Umar bin Khattab, or confirming rather the opinion of Umar bin Khattab radiallahu anhu. The greatest tribute to him is paid by Ali radiallahu anhu. When Umar radiallahu anhu passed away and Ali radiallahu anhu was in the room when he took his last breath, he said, Allah will have mercy on you, Umar. How many times didn't I hear my Nabi saying, Ana wa Abi Bakr wa Umar. Umar, myself, Abu Bakr and Umar went here. Myself, Abu Bakr and Umar, we did this. Abu Bakr, Umar and myself, we are about to go here. These were the two constant companions, the two lieutenants, the two deputies, the right hand and the left hand of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Give the Quran a chance. Give the seerah a chance. Give the legacy of the sahaba a chance to work its magic in our lives. We are like those people who are in the desert. We're suffering from thirst, but we have water in our hands. We are suffering from the spiritual thirst, and Allah has given us all the spiritual water. We just need to activate it. Lastly, boycott of Banu Hashim. I think I got 5 minutes left, so we'll try and cover that. So here the Muslims go to Abyssinia, and they're settling very comfortably there, right? And then you've got in Makkah what has happened? Umar radiallahu anhu has accepted Islam, and Hamza radiallahu anhu has accepted Islam. Two very brave individuals. When Umar radiallahu anhu accepted Islam, it is after that that the Muslims started performing salah publicly. It is after that that they started proclaiming and calling people to Islam and doing da'wah openly. Umar had such courage in his convictions. He had such courage in his convictions. May Allah reward them for the sacrifice that they made, because of which today you and I utter the kalima. After he accepted Islam, he went to the biggest gossip monger in Makkah. You know, the person that he knew, if you tell him, the story would spread. They say, if you want something to spread, tell your wife and tell her not to tell her mother. Right, so he went and he told that man that, listen, I've accepted Islam. He hardly had the words come out from his mouth. That man ran to the haram and he proclaimed loudly, Umar has accepted Islam. And they pounced on him and he took the beating. Why? Because he wanted the door to be open. Give me the hiding, but let it be known. Because once it is known, it's going to open the doors for open da'wah. And so it happened. So it happened. And constantly, Sahaba used to reflect back to the acceptance of Islam by Umar radiallahu anhu. When he made hijrah, he went to the Kaaba and he made announcement, hey, I am going from Makkah to Medina, I'm making hijrah. Anyone got the guts, try and stop me. Anyone got the guts, try and stop me. And he made hijrah openly and publicly. So here you had the Muslims who are now thriving in Abyssinia. And you had Umar and you had Hamza who accepted Islam. And now the Muslims are, you know, making da'wah openly. And the numbers are increasing. So this presented a huge problem for the mushrikeen, for the leaders of the Quraysh. They didn't know what to do. So they decided now that, you know what, enough is enough. We need to make them feel the pain where they will feel it the most. And the greatest challenge for a human to face is isolation. It's isolation. Ask those people who are subject to the kind of torture in Guantanamo and everywhere else. You know, it's not the beating. It's not the waterboarding. It's when you're left totally in isolation, because human beings are interactive by nature. So it's not economic sanctions, it's not political sanctions, it's isolation. And this is where the mushrikeen said, we're going to hit them. We're going to sever all ties with them. We're going to put up a treaty. The treaty was written. It was stuck into the interior walls of the Kaaba. No political association, no social association, no economic association. Not only with the Nabi of Allah and the Sahaba, the entire tribes. The whole Banu Hashim and the whole Banu Muttalib. Why? Because there were many from amongst those tribes who were not Muslim. But listen, they were giving protection to their relatives. They said, no, they are our relatives, we won't allow you to touch them. So you will also suffer because you don't want to give them over to us. How ironic. How ironic. You know, we talk so negatively about the pagans, but the one good quality they had, Abu Talib never became a Muslim. But he showed solidarity with his nephew. He showed solidarity with his nephew. Today we share the kalima, but we're the first to set up our brothers. And we're the last to show solidarity with them. That is really an irony. They suffered for 3 years in the valley of Abu Talib, even though many of them were not Muslims. But they said, you will not touch our relatives. You will not touch our relatives. Now what happened there? This was no ordinary boycott. Nobody was allowed to buy from them. Nobody was allowed to sell to them. Abu Lahab, the own uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the own man who freed his slave girl when she brought him the news of the birth of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So happy he was. He used to go to the traders and say, I will pay you not to sell to them. I will pay you, the traders coming from outside, I will pay you not to sell to them. And what was the result and the consequence of that? Before I even go to that, one thought comes to my mind. One day I heard from one scholar, and I think it's so relevant to the lives of so many people. They say in life, you'll get your greatest support from those who are close to you. Many times it's family. But then sometimes in life, your greatest enemies will also emerge from those who are closest to you. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's greatest support came from Khadija radiallahu anha and Abu Talib. But his greatest enemy, more than Abu Jahl was an enemy, it was Abu Lahab, because that was his own uncle. That was his flesh and blood, who left no stone unturned in harming Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Talib was such that even in this 3 years boycott, right, it's not mentioned there, but I've read it elsewhere, that one day the mushrikeen said, hey, but these people, their resolve is not breaking. They're still steadfast. We have to kill Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Talib heard about it, and he heard that the plan was to kill the Nabi of Allah at night when it was dark in his sleep, so nobody would know who did it. So there would be no case of revenge. That night he came to the Nabi of Allah and said, you know what, man? I'm an old man, I think your bed is a bit more comfortable. Let me sleep in your bed, you take my bed. That's the extent to which Abu Talib went. But Hidayat was written for Amr bin As, who was the enemy. For Khalid bin Walid, who was the enemy. Hidayat was not written for Abu Talib. Hidayat was written for us. Let's appreciate that Hidayat and guidance that was written for us. Because it wasn't written for the son of Nuh alayhi salam, or for the father of Ibrahim alayhi salam, or for the beloved uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I just mentioned two or three stories and conclude in terms of the difficulties that the Muslims went through in the 3 year boycott. It is said that Sa'ad bin Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu said, one day I was so hungry, I found a piece of camel leather that was shriveled. I took it, I burnt it, I made powder out of it, and that was my meal for 3 days. That was my meal for 3 days. You know, you can suffer, but to see your children suffer is unbearable. The children used to cry out of the pangs of hunger. Those cries used to echo in the valleys of Makkah. Imagine what kind of iman the Sahaba had. Today our child has a bit of a fever, a bit of a fit, is to go to the clinic for overnight, and we lose our senses. You know, I can tolerate pain, but my son mustn't suffer. Imagine what went through Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's heart when his beloved Fatima radiallahu anha was a child at that time, who was crying from the pangs of hunger. Now ulama have written that Fatima radiallahu anha passed away at a very young age, a few years after Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a few months. And one of the reasons for her demise, the apparent reason was, that because her upbringing, her physical upbringing was compromised due to the harsh conditions in this valley for the 3 years, it had a perpetual impact on her health until it led to her demise. But look at the iman of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And at this point, mothers and sisters, look at the loyalty of Khadija radiallahu anha. She had all the money. She could have left her husband in the lurch, citing her children. But listen, I'd like to be here with you. I can suffer with you, but why must our children suffer? Why must Fatima suffer? Let me break ranks and go back to Makkah and look after the children. No. She showed solidarity, and she showed that support to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that's why Allah chose her to be the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's wife at that particular time. Another one incident it is mentioned that with regards to that particular time, that once I think Hakim bin Hizam was going to give his auntie Khadija radiallahu anha some food. After a while he felt bad. So our relatives are suffering. And Abu Jahl caught him and intercepted him, and an argument broke out. And another person came and saw Abu Jahl, and they got so infuriated by what was happening that they actually beat Abu Jahl. They beat him up. But this prevailed. It prevailed for 3 years. Until these five individuals whose names you see in that column there, one by one, Allah put it in their hearts. And they started thinking, this is not on. And Hisham bin Amr said, Abu Jahl's relatives are eating and our relatives are suffering. The other said that we got no support. Then they said that we are five of us, let's try something. And they went to the haram at the time and they knew everyone was gathered. And they said, how is it that we can continue to let these people suffer like this? And then there was a common echo and a common chorus. And Abu Jahl tried to put out some resistance, but he was overwhelmed. And the majority decision was, we must bring it to an end. Simultaneously, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told Abu Talib that, you know, that accord, that document that they wrote, that, you know, the boycott will take place, and they've stuck into the internal walls of the Kaaba. That man who wrote it, incidentally, Allah punished him immediately. His hands became paralyzed. He could never use his hands after that, after he wrote that accord. But Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told Abu Talib that accord inside the Kaaba, it was inside the Kaaba, so people were not looking at it all the time. The ants have eaten all of it except the part where the name of Allah is written, except the part where there's Bismillah written. So Abu Talib met with the Quraysh and he said that, this is what my nephew told me. He said, impossible. He said, okay, here's the deal. Let's open the Kaaba. If indeed it's been eaten, you free us. If not, you can continue to persecute us. And when they opened, then they found that it was eaten and this 3-year boycott came to an end. But that was not the end of the road for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The next year became perhaps the most difficult year in his life. But obviously that is the topic of discussion for the next speaker. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala grant us the enthusiasm to continuously study the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba for as long as we live. And may Allah bless us with the ability to imbibe and to internalize those teachings and to become the true adherents of the Sahaba and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And may Allah unite us with them in Jannatul Firdaus for eternity. Ameen ya Rabbal Alameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.